How did it start? How did the what was the first warning sign?
Well, it sort of came from nowhere in a way, because he had been at home homeschooling. It was in the week running up to lockdown. And so the lockdown had begun. He'd had a week of schools not being there. And so he wasn't really going anywhere, and he was fine. But he had had for weeks and weeks and weeks a painful shoulder. And he started saying, I just feel so unwell. I think it's these new painkillers that I'm taking. I think they're making me feel quite sick. I think I might be getting sinusitis. And at that point, sinusitis wasn't considered a symptom. And I remember, you know, ringing the doctor and saying this, and they said, oh, no, that's fine. Has he got a cough? Has he got a temperature? And I said, no, although it's only me that's taken the temperature, but he didn't look like he had a temperature either. Sure. And and then suddenly I came home from Smooth and I said to him, you do not look right. You just look grey. I don't know what's going on. He said, I've got such a bad headache and my whole body aches. And I said, I'm going to ring someone and try to 111. Tried our doctors, which were closed actually, and couldn't get through. So then did what anyone who's worked in breakfast television does, is ring Dr. Hilary Jones. So I rang Dr. Hilary Jones and he said, let him put me on the phone. And he did some sort of timing test for breathing. And I kept saying to him, is your chest tight? Do you feel like you can't breathe? And he said, no, it doesn't feel tight. It's just in my head. But he just said, I think you need to call an ambulance. I think he seems like he can't hold his breath for long enough.
So even though he hadn't clocked that himself, because he hadn't, I mean, it took Dr. Hillary doing the counting.
He wasn't coughing. He just felt, he held it how long he could hold his breath. So he didn't feel like there was a wheezing or anything.
Sure.
So it was all very asymptomatic. And you know, and even when I called the ambulance, you know, I sort of tidied up the hall.
Yes.
Because I thought, oh gosh, the ambulance is coming, better tidy the hall. I wasn't in a drowning moment, you know.
Yes, I do.
And it's only when the ambulance arrived, obviously, in their full hazmat. And I actually thought, gosh, I'm, you know, there's probably pretty people that are really ill with COVID. And, you know, and I can't believe I'm disturbing the ambulance in a very sort of British way.
I was about to say, yeah, that's about as British as it
gets. But it was so busy. Dear. That was the weekend when we were all told, you know, don't do anything. Don't, you know, even if you've got a broken leg, try and avoid disturbing the doctors who are dealing with serious consequences. Anyway, they came and said, oh, no, they did blood tests and said, we need to go to hospital now. And so he got in the ambulance and off he went. And but even for the first week or so, you know, it all looked relatively positive in the sense that obviously it was terrifying because we were terrified and worried out of our wits, you know. But he was still able to text, and you know, was sending texts saying, oh, you know, they say that the x-ray looks hopeful and all of this. So we were sort of still in a good place, and then it just suddenly went wham. And they said, we need to put induced in a coma now. And then they said, you know, we're going to have to transfer him. And then they rang and said, we're not sure he's going to be well enough to be transferred. And it was just...
Are we talking about hours? It just went from...
overnight, basically. So from the night before to him saying, I'm going to try and get some sleep.
Yeah.
To a phone call the next morning saying, we're putting him into a coma. And then it just escalated in the next 24 hours to he's hanging by a thread.
Good.
He's hanging by a thread. And since then, it's been weeks of thinking some things are improving and then some things don't. And what I think we've all learnt as a country, and certainly the medical profession has learnt, is that this isn't just a lung disease. This is a virus that attacks every cell in the body.
Yes.
Or can do. Yes. And I don't want to scare people, because some people get it and it's very mild, you know. But it's not something you mess about with, because Derek had no underlying conditions. He was a bit chubby, let's be honest. And I loved him for it.
I may have seen him scarfing a muffin back in February at that event.
He's not chubby now, so that's he's lost a huge amount of weight.
Of course he has.
But you know, so some, I think there have been reports at various points, haven't there, about that?
Yes,
not clinically obese or anything, you know. So there's no reason why. And yet he remains, for the medical profession that have treated him, which are now running into hundreds with all the various shifts, maybe more, they say he's the sickest person they've ever treated. They can't believe it.
And they don't know why.
They don't know why yet. I'm sure they will know why. But it's because of the way it's affected him. So he hasn't got the coronavirus now. He hasn't got COVID. He's clear of it. What he's dealing with is the damage. And I think this is what we're going to see more of increasingly, hopefully.
Of course.
Not to the degree of Derek's. I think there's one other person in the UK that's been almost as severely affected.
How do you process that, Kate? How do you process the sheer bloody unfairness of what you've just described?
It's a very, very good question, because I do have moments of, oh, why?
Of course.
But then, you know, you think, he's lived, and there are thousands of families. You know, I don't want to cry, but there are thousands of families who've had the worst news, aren't there? And I haven't, you know, I have the hope of that. So, you know, why them? Yeah. You know, why the nurses that have gone in to treat people, you know, the medical professionals that have lost their lives, you know. But you're right, it's mercifully unfair. It's mercifully unfair, you know.
Just is, isn't it?
But it just is for everyone,
it just
you know.
Is.
It's for the people that are, you know, suffering with mental health because of the... It's all of it. It's just really unfair.
He left you a note, I think, before he went into the coma.
So there are two things that happened. He left an actual note in a suitcase because I'd had to go away overnight just before he got sick, just saying, this is going to be our year. Yeah. And you're doing so brilliantly. I know. And I saw it at the time, obviously, and then re-found it when I had to pack some things to take in for him, because they've allowed us to take him pictures and so that he can have near him to sort of, and iPad and things like that. But when he was going into the coma, it's a complicated message in hindsight, because he was actually really wanting to go into the coma because he was finding it so hard to breathe. He felt like he was suffocating. So he was texting me saying, persuade them you're good at this. Persuade them to put them into a coma. Talk to them. I mean, there's nobody more persuasive than Derek, but I don't know what you thought I could do. But also I was saying, listen, I am, but they're saying it's better for you not to. So, you know, you have to stick with it. But we're talking to them all the time. And the doctors are saying to me, if we can keep his lungs working on their own, that's better. So it was a balance between the exhaustion and...
Yes.
Anyway, they rang and they said, he's with me now. We've got to put him into a coma now. He's on speakerphone. You can talk to him. And he shouted, you know, I love you. You saved my life. Thank you.
What did he mean?
Well, I thought, first of all, he meant that... I said, it wasn't me. They're doing it for them. And he said, no, I don't just mean now. I mean, you saved my life, the children, the family, everything. It's everything. I'm sorry I've got to leave you, but... it'll just be for 3 to 5 days, which is more than 100 days ago.
You did save his life, I think.
Well, you know, I think kind his of family and
knew
family
him a bit
life.
Back in the day, but when you got together, a lot of people were very surprised, weren't they? They didn't. There was a bit of a chalk and cheese thing going on, but it is.
I think to people that didn't know us,
yes, exactly,
we look extraordinary. I'm 5'2", he's 6'3". You know, he's really loud, and
you can say that again.
I mean, I know I talk a lot. I can't forget. You can say that again, says James. Having been on the other wrong side. Yeah, I know, and I'm not quiet. I can't pretend to be that. I'm not a mouse. But, yeah, we did seem very different. And he's, like, so proud of being from Lancashire. He's kind of professionally northern. And I'm such a sort of little home counties girl. So it does look like an extraordinary mix. But then as soon as you got to know us, we're actually very similar. You know, his family, who have been amazing throughout this as well, and are obviously in bits, you know, son and brother. And have been so lovely. And, of course, for them, they can't visit. They can't do anything. You know, it's so hard. So, you know, he's always been a homeboy, really, and that's been his greatest pleasure. You might tell of other stories.
On the contrary, I think it is. It's a proper love story. You know, that's no doubt one of the things that sustained you and kept you strong during this incredible period. You don't need me to tell you how much love has come in via the various social media channels and text messages, Kate, but everyone's rooting for Derek and everyone's rooting for you as well.
Well, thank you very much indeed, and we've just got to all together, haven't we, stand together and work our way out of this maze.